And religions, I suppose, had assemblies too, but they weren't anything like when the saints got together.
Yeah.
So I'm very thankful for them.
Amen.
If two are better than one, I mean, well, 50 or 60 is really better than one.
Amen.
Tonight, this will be our 68th exposition of John. We're going to be in the fifth chapter, verses 41 through 44. Now, you've probably noticed this, observed in your dealings with people in general, that honoring Jesus is really not considered by the normal people to be important. Most people are quite willing to leave Jesus in the realm of human opinion and conjecture, and if you want to talk about that, that's all right for you and this sort of thing, but he's generally not seen as being relevant to or pertinent to living, essential for life. Quite common for men to consider their own lives, their family, making a living, having pleasure is more important than, than Christ. This is where we all have a ministry. You can live out a truth that can be seen by people, that this is an improper way to live. I think that few people really believe that without Christ you can do nothing. That's nothing that pertains to God.
Yeah,
I mean, you can sin without Christ.
That's right.
But you can't do anything that God requires you to do without Christ.
Yeah.
It'd be hard to find someone who would instantly respond with an agreement that Jesus is presently upholding all things by the word of his power. He's presently doing this.
Yeah.
These are things that are common to believers, but are not so common to people who are not. Most people don't associate Jesus as being absolutely necessary to life, or matters of importance. Matters of extreme importance aren't generally associated with Christ. This is the environment we live in. But of course, living like that without Christ being at the center is actually a life of great jeopardy.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
A person is, it's kind of like walking over the lake of fire on rotten boards. It's kind of like that.
Yeah.
Very jeopardous, very dangerous. I would venture to say also that the kinds of Christianity that most people are exposed to don't make people uncomfortable living that way. That, of course, can be altered by our own influence to some degree. Now, we're going to talk tonight about Jesus and honoring him. It's a big word, honoring him. And Jesus is going to speak to us very candidly about this. He's speaking, remember, to this group of people that objected to him healing the man on the Sabbath day and of saying that God was his father. So this is verses 41 through 44 of the fifth chapter. I receive not honor from men, but I know you, that ye have not the love of God in you. I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him ye will receive. How can ye believe, which receive honor one of another, and seek not the honor that cometh from God only?
Amen.
Well, these are very, very resting. How can you believe? These are very, very resting questions. Now this, I'm intrigued by this expression, I received not honor from men. I receive not honor from men. Other versions say, I don't receive glory from men, or I don't accept praise from men, or I do not accept glory from human beings. The Living Translation says, your approval means nothing to me. Amplified Bible says, I receive not glory from men, I crave no human honor, I look for no mortal fame. All right, now that flies squarely in the face of some current views of praise and worship. Just head on. There are some that consider the primary activity of the church to be praise. Now you're going to have a hard time integrating that with this verse we just read. This is not the primary thing with Jesus. Actually, properly considered, the praise that honors God is the praise of a person's life.
Yes, amen.
Now this is stated in Scripture. We ought to draw attention to it. Ephesians 1:11-12. I say this because this has become popular. I remember when this started to become popular. This wasn't, when I was a young man, this was like unheard of. This was totally unheard of. But it is, there's people have careers that hinge on this. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his glory, who first trusted in Christ. So this is where the glory that our text is talking about, this is where it comes from. Mm-hmm. It comes from the lives of the people. Again, as stated, Philippians 1:11, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ, unto the praise, unto the glory and praise of God. See, it's not what comes out of your mouth. It's what comes out of your life.
Yeah, that's right.
And if your life is lived, praise will come from your mouth. We understand that. Mm-hmm. So let's look at this stuff a bit more closely. Jesus does not seek honor from men. That's what he's saying there. Mm-hmm. He doesn't say, no person can ever give me honor. That's not what he's saying. He said he doesn't seek this. In the divine economy, all men, this is John 5:23, should honor the Son as they honor the Father. Amen. But here should does not mean ought.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
I want to take a little bit of time on this. The full statement is represented in the American Standard Version. You can see it in the other versions too. It's found in the preceding verse also. For not even the Father judges anyone, but he has given all judgment unto the Son in order that all may honor the Son. So the fact, this the honor he's talking about, all, in other words, all men couldn't honor the Son if it wasn't for the fact that God gave all the judgment to him. So once you see that your life is in Jesus' hand, he's going to determine where you spend eternity.
That's right. Yep.
All judgment's been given to the Son. Anyone that's saved, anyone that's damned, is going to be executed by Jesus. Once a person sees that, that compels him to honor the Son.
Yes.
Amen. I mean, it's foolish. You can see how foolish it would be not to honor the Son.
Yeah.
God has charged, God has not told Jesus, make men give honor to you. Has not caused men to give honor to you. If you got to be made to give honor to Jesus, that won't save you. Because everybody is eventually going to give honor to Jesus.
Amen.
They're going to bow their knee to him and confess that he's the Lord. But for some, it's not going to count for any good. So the type of honor he's talking about is insightful honor. When the person sees who Jesus is, your life is not in the hands of the person you work for.
Amen. That's right, yes.
Yes.
If you're a child, your life is not in the hand of your parents.
Amen.
Your life is in the hands of Christ. God's given
Amen.
All things into his hand. Yes.
I keep thinking that praise is comely in the mouth of the righteous.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes back to what you said about the life being, actually the life proceeds, it makes it comely for the verbal expression of it, because it's fitting. Just like he wouldn't let the demons confess who he was, they weren't fitting vessels for
him.
They weren't fit to handle the truth. So it's comely for the righteous.
Amen.
And they're the ones, now that you're talking about insightful, they're really the only ones that can give a true praise.
That's right.
Everything
else
is pretentious.
In
the book of Hebrews, I believe it is, tells us that praise is giving thanks. Giving thanks is praise is insightful, in other words.
Yeah, that's
it's giving thanks to God because you've seen who Jesus is, what he's done, what he's doing. You see it, you praise him, and this thanks comes from you.
So this is a spiritual conclusion.
That's right.
See, where some teach that when you praise, you're speaking something out that is altering your character.
Yeah.
But that's not true.
No.
Jesus has altered your character in order that you might praise.
That's exactly.
Yeah,
praise doesn't cause altered character. Altered character causes praise.
It's
just turned around.
Yeah, Jesus brings understanding.
Yes.
As soon as you get that understanding, then you know to honor the one that brought it.
Yeah. That's right. Amen. Yeah. Yes, Brother Jim.
Even in the world, it's a foreign concept to force somebody to worship anything.
That's right.
For some, it might be a car, it might be a home, it might be a job. Whatever it is that people worship, nobody tells them, you need to worship that thing.
That's right.
Where the affections go, praise is there. That's why it's so foreign in the church to tell people they ought to praise. If they have to be told they ought to, something's missing on the front end
of
that.
Right.
That's right.
Amen.
Once they see it, they can't help but.
Amen.
Yes. Amen.
If you see that there should be more praise, then there should be a commitment to give them a good reason to open this thing up.
Amen.
So people will have a reason to praise God.
Amen.
And then you won't be able to stop them. Now you notice, a point I'm making here is that Jesus was not charged with causing people to honor him. The psalmist, second psalm, which is a messianic psalm. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power. Amplifies it a little bit. In the beauties of holiness from the womb of the morning, thou hast the dew of youth. Notice. God's power is the cause for the praise and willingness, but the willingness is associated with holiness, the beauties of holiness, and with enlightenment in the womb of the morning.
Amen.
Now that's the kind of honor that brings honor to Jesus, honor that proceeds from insight, from divine power, from seeing who Jesus is and being enlightened, seeing and a holy life.
Amen.
I will go so far as to say an unholy person cannot give honor to God or Christ.
Yeah.
They may go through some kind of a mechanical.
That's right.
But an unholy person, this is just the way the kingdom of God is, an unholy person cannot offer acceptable praise and honor to God or Christ.
What was said through the prophets Isaiah and Amos.
That's right.
To both the kingdoms. Don't come before me this way. I will not accept it. I will not receive it.
Who told you to tread my courts?
Yeah.
What are you doing in my courts? When Jesus came to earth, he knew he was going to be despised and rejected of men. Now, he knew that. And he would not seek to change that circumstance. He wasn't going to alter his conduct to induce people not to despise him. He said, I receive not honor from men. That's a straight out statement, but it's certainly conducive to a lot of thinking, a lot of thought. Those who honor the Son believe in him, they obey him and they follow him and they live for him. They don't honor him with their lips while their heart's far from him. And Jesus, he didn't come to be honored by men. That isn't even why he came. He did his work. Those who see his work give him honor. But that's not why he came. Yes.
This honor that we keep talking about and referring to praise leads me to think that this type of thing cannot be scripted. So we see Jesus do something, and then we have to look right quick in the manual to see what we have to say about this. When Jesus does this in section A, number 6, it's coming from, we understand what Jesus is doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. So that text says, they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. If your heart is near to God, your lips will also honor them, like
that's
it's
right.
honor him, like it's been said already.
That's right.
We can say, without contradiction, that insightful men will give honor to the Son. They will. They believe on him. They're depending on him. Their life is in his hands. They see what Jesus did for them, and now they lay down their lives for him. They give honor to the Son. We want to make sure that this is always in any gatherings. That there's a preeminent honoring of the Son. To think in terms of what would Jesus, how would Jesus regard this assembly? Because we got the numerous examples of Jesus being in assemblies.
Amen. This very thing you just mentioned, because I had a conversation with someone on Facebook about this, about the, he was dealing with some symptoms. And I got to talking to him about, you know, the root problem is that if a person hasn't seen Jesus, they haven't really experienced the real Christ, they won't bring anything to that altar. They won't give up anything.
That's right.
It won't produce in them a desire to lay down anything.
Yeah.
And that's the real problem. It isn't all this other stuff. That's a symptom. But the fact that if we can get them introduced to Jesus, you won't have to tell them. They'll come and they'll lay down. They'll lay it down, that's whatever right. it is.
That's right.
See, wayward and inconsistent lives do not and cannot honor Christ.
Amen.
And there is nothing a person, no act or procedure or manner of life a person can do that will compensate for wayward living. I know that there are people who think they live out of the garbage can all week, and then they come and they sing some songs, and they think that that offsets this other. It doesn't.
That's right.
It compounds the problem.
Amen. Yes.
Because God won't receive this. He won't receive unholy lips pretending like they're honoring him. He won't receive it. And as Brother Gene pointed out, this is it. This is one of the strains of the prophets. They dealt with this quite a bit.
Amen.
And God just said, well, wait, I don't want to hear any more of it. I can't stand your songs. That's what he told them. Get them out of my presence. Who told you even to come into my courts? So it has an adverse effect upon God. And yet, those who live under a system of works, whether they explain it this way or not, they think if there's something they can do that can offset this lack of commitment to Christ and this lack of thanksgiving, this lack of subjection to Christ, they think there's something they can do that will offset that. It's got to be eliminated.
Amen.
Not offset.
And much of our teaching that I'm hearing out there is actually fortifying the fact that men can't do this.
Well, yes.
They can't. They're stuck. God understands. Yeah. One of these days he's going to deliver us and take us to heaven. But this whole thing is never addressed. And where right now, we can be victorious right now. Never, it's never mentioned.
There is such a thing as a new creation.
Amen.
There is.
Brother, this is consistent with John the Baptist in my understanding. Matthew 3, when some of the Pharisees and Sadducees came to him for baptism, he said, who warned you to flee?
That's right.
And he was not going to allow them to engage in some empty ritual.
He was preparing the way for the Lord. So that's the way you come to the Lord, by discarding what's not acceptable. Yeah,
he told them to prepare for the preparation.
That's right. Amen.
Brother Gibbon. I'm reminded of the times when they offered sacrifices and the Lord didn't accept their sacrifices. And in Amos, it says, though you offer me burnt offerings and meat offerings, I will not accept them.
Yes,
and then the next verse, it says, take away from me the noise of thy song.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
It's really noise to God. And people think that, I'm just going to be wayward, which is a total misrepresentation of what Christ actually does in a person. He doesn't create them to be wayward. He creates them to be sons.
Amen. That's right. Amen. Noise. That's right. Boy, you don't want to be noisy when you're in God's presence.
Amen.
Loud and noise aren't the same thing, you understand? Now, those who don't honor the Son don't honor the Father. That's the point we want to develop here very briefly. Jesus said, he that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father. Honor the Son doesn't mean put him on a pedestal. It doesn't mean have his name over on a church sign. That's not what it means. Honor the Son means to listen to him, obey him, follow him, live for him. You got to go where he goes. The deal isn't he goes where you go. See, it's not this. That's not how it's set up. The psalmist of that second psalm, which is a messianic psalm, says, kiss the Son, lest he be angry and ye perish in the way when his wrath is kindled but a little. Let's not talk about the Son of God.
Amen.
Blessed are all that put their trust in him. So the ultimate honor to Jesus is so to kiss the Son.
That's right.
Not like Judas did. Like that woman that kissed his feet did.
Yes,
that kind of kiss. A thankful and honoring kiss. Kiss the Son. Because he'll be angry if you don't.
Yes. Amen.
Now it's good to ask yourself the question, have I kissed the Son? Am I kissing the Son?
Yeah.
Sometimes when you're setting out to do this or setting out to do that, you'll be brought up short, like a warning, like a caution light will come on. You better think this over. When you come to a point like that, kiss the Son.
Amen.
Defer to Jesus.
Yes.
You know how God's going to respond to that.
Yes.
See, these other things, you don't know how God will respond back off. Oh, yeah, this is a safe, for you it's safe to do that. Back off from what you're not sure about and kiss the Son. Make sure he's present. And you'll kiss him because he's precious to you. And you that believe, he is precious, Peter said. He said, he's a living stone, disallowed indeed of men, but chosen of God and precious.
Yes.
See, precious. Whatever we can do without it can't be Jesus. We can do without a lot of things we can't do with.
Amen.
We can't do without Jesus. We can do without the praises of the commendations of men. We can do without them. We not without Jesus' commendation.
Amen.
We can't do without that. He's chosen. Whoever believes on him will not be confounded. You'll never have any regrets for doing that. Technically speaking, we do not honor the Son because of what he's done for us. in keeping with our text, we honor the Son because God has given all judgment to Him. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So He's due the honor.
Amen.
He's due the honor. That's because right. God has given all judgment to Him. Uh-huh. And Jesus, as will be confirmed in the next clause, He does not receive honor from those who do not love God. He's going to develop this. He doesn't receive it. If a person doesn't love God, and you can only love God one way, mm-hmm. with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength, there isn't any other way.
Yeah.
At your input. Yeah, this is the love of God, that we keep His commandments. Yeah. See, and God won't receive honor or praise or worship or anything else from someone that doesn't love Him. It won't happen. But if they do, He will receive it. Yeah. See, that's the way we thank God for that.
Yes.
It continues, I know you. Jesus can speak that to your heart, and when you're sometimes in solitude, mm-hmm. He'll say to you, I know you.
Yeah.
Amen. Now, you don't want to melt when He says that.
Yeah.
You want to tell Him, oh, search my heart, try me, and see if there's any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting.
Yes,
so you want to say something like that.
Yeah.
I know you. We may not know you, but Jesus knows you.
Yes.
Other versions say, I have knowledge of you. The Jerusalem Bible says, I do not know you people. So he's talking to a group. Hmm. I know what kind of people you are, God's Word Bible says. Hmm. New Jerusalem Bible says, I know you too well. Young's literal says, I've known you. So this hasn't taken me by surprise at all. Mm. The Amplified Bible says, I know you and recognize and understand you. Mm-hmm. I do. See, you never have to explain your conduct or your thoughts to Christ.
Yes, amen.
never try to explain yourself. You know, sometimes we have to explain ourselves to one another because of our clumsy expression, but you'd never want to engage in explaining something you did to God or explain why you said something to God or Christ. You don't want to do that because He knows. He knows you. So what does He know about these people? He says, you have not the love of God in you. What a statement. You have no love for God in your hearts. In your hearts, you do not really love God. Contemporary English version says, none of you love God. Now, the first and great commandment under the law was this, I shall love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, all thy soul, all thy mind, all thy strength. This is the first and great commandment.
Yeah.
He's talking to Jews who knew that commandment. They could have recited it. Any one of them could have recited it. Said what it said. Everybody knew that was the first commandment. You remember a scribe once asked Jesus, what's the great commandment? And Jesus told him, the scribe said, well, that's right. See,
yeah.
They all knew what the first commandment was.
Yeah.
And any person that's like what we might call a church person, mm-hmm. they're able to tell you what the first commandment is under the law.
Yeah.
The commandments are different under Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Got to understand this, because this is His commandment, singular. This is His commandment to believe on His Son and love one another.
Yeah,
yeah. Now the love of God's all wrapped up in that.
You
understand? But that's how it's stated in Christ.
Wow, yeah.
This is not the commandment that the apostles told the churches. They went down into it. They gave a microscopic view of that commandment. See,
mm-hmm.
believe on His Son. That's your ultimate way to love God, is to react to His Son
Amen.
Correctly.
Amen.
And love the brethren, which are His people.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they knew this commandment, but he told them, you don't have the love of God. It's not in your heart. Now, He's the only one that could actually make that statement
yeah.
with precision. Mm-hmm. You never want to take it upon yourself to give that assessment of someone, that's not in our circumference of our responsibility. But he does do this. He knows who loves God and who doesn't love God. He knows this. So if you can assist people in being God conscious and Christ conscious, see, then they'll come. This will mean something to them. But as long as people are not God conscious, they'll just be as hard as these people Jesus was talking to here. They won't get it. See, the purpose to be carried out by the church is to make people God conscious. And within the framework of God consciousness, to tell them what God has done through Christ to resolve the sin situation. Because once you're God conscious, you're sin conscious.
Yeah, amen.
And you want to know a remedy. Then we have the gospel for them. So I know this. Now, for us, by their fruits, you know them. That's not how Jesus operates.
Yeah.
Jesus didn't know this because he saw fruit. Mm-hmm. He knew this by divine perception. See, there's a difference. We got to look at fruit.
Yeah.
Jesus doesn't have to look at fruit. He just looks right straight at the heart.
That's right. Amen.
The outside may look like good fruit.
Uh-huh.
See? But inside, that's where he looks. I know you. You don't have the love of God in you. Men can adjust their lives to be very meticulous. Jesus said to the Pharisees, "You appear to be righteous, and within you're full of dead men's bones." Because that's not the way they looked. They didn't look like men full of dead men's bones.
Yeah.
See, so Jesus, he could look into the heart. And now when you're in Christ, you bank on this.
Yeah.
Amen.
You count on Jesus being able to look at your heart. Because sometimes
Amen.
You sense your own verbalization and expression is like flawed. And you're not satisfied with the way you said it. But you can rely on Jesus searching your heart. Yes, Brother Jonathan.
Yeah, he knows the hearts, but he makes known what's in the heart also.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like God does this. Is he tries the rings in the hearts. This is not to figure out what's there. He's revealing what's there. He knows what's there, and he knows how to get what's really inside you out.
That's right.
And manifest what a person really is.
Amen.
He did that with everyone. Everyone was
Amen.
Shown to be what they really are when they were confronted with Jesus.
Amen.
In fact, you can... this is like a principle of the kingdom. What is known is eventually made known.
Uh-huh.
God's this way. He's going to make everything known. Now we make things known. Whatever you know, you're to make known.
Yeah.
That's the way the kingdom works.
Mm-hmm.
So we all don't have to like learn the hard way.
Yeah, right.
It's not that way. Mm-hmm. You're part of a family that there's aspects of God's mind and knowledge and purpose being revealed to here and there to different people. And if you get these people together, they begin sharing what they've seen. See, you all of a sudden you gotta.
Amen.
A lot of things you learn, you don't have to learn the hard way. You don't have to learn the hard way that Satan can take everything you got and you can still keep your faith. You don't have to learn it the hard way. God set up a man to teach you that, Job.
Yeah.
You don't have to learn the hard way that you could be really, really smart and go to hell. You don't have to learn it the hard way. God set up Solomon.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Amen.
See, so that's the way the kingdom of God works. It's a sign of God's mercy and grace that he's... It operates like this. I don't think anyone could have thought of this, of doing it this way. Only God. So when these people didn't have the love of God, they not only presented a handicap for themselves, they handicapped everyone that knew them too. Everyone that knew them was handicapped too. They were limited by this condition. Now he says, I am come in my Father's name. Other versions say it in his authority. God didn't come himself because the world would have just, it'd have been gone. That'd have been it.
Right.
See, God is righteous. He's so righteous, there has to be a buffer zone between you and God. There has to be some kind of buffer or you'd never survive.
Amen.
No matter how much God loves you or Jesus loves you or anybody else.
Mm-hmm.
If there wasn't this buffer of a mediator, an intercessor, and the Holy Spirit interceding, and all this in the body of Christ, if this buffer wasn't there, God would destroy us by his presence. That's why this whole plan has been offered of redemption in Christ Jesus. That's why it's that way.
Yeah.
God's provided more for himself than for you.
Yeah. Yeah, amen.
Okay. Jesus is even more necessary for God than he is for you. Mm-hmm. Because without Jesus, God's nature won't let him save people.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's too holy.
Amen.
He is just too holy. Mm-hmm. And Jesus is holy too, but he trekked down here. Mm-hmm. He trekked down here, and it suited him to be a suitable mediator for us, an intercessor. Yes?
Yeah, a lot of that's just made. God is righteous and Jesus is righteous, so what will righteous God do when he sees Jesus in you?
That's
yeah.
right.
Uh-huh.
He'll bless you.
That's right.
He's his beloved son.
So wherever Jesus was, God is with him. Mm-hmm. Right?
Amen.
When he's in the wilderness, God is with him. Right? He's in a city, God's with him. Mm-hmm. He goes on a mountain, God's with him. Yep. He's in a boat going across the sea, God's with him. If he's in you, God's with him. That's the way it works. Praise God.
Amen.
Now, what Jesus, I'm coming in my Father's name. Jesus said, the works that I do in my Father's name. That is to say, what I do is precisely what God would do. If God was here, this, what I do is what God would do.
Yes, amen.
If I say something, that's what God would say. Mm-hmm. You don't have to speculate about what would God say about if Jesus has spoken. That's exactly, he's the precise representation of God. Mm-hmm. Everything he said and did was precisely what God would have said and did.
Yes.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
That's why it is written, God, Jesus was God manifest or made known in the flesh. His name was Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. See, now only God could strike on this kind of a remedy. To have his fullness, right? Mm-hmm. His fullness dwell among men without consuming them.
Yeah.
Amen.
So he had to put it in the body. Mm-hmm. In Christ, the fullness of the Godhead dwelt in him bodily. So he put it in Christ's body. Uh-huh. And here's what Jesus pointed out is, these people didn't recognize this. These people didn't connect Jesus of Nazareth with God the Father. God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. Jesus said one time to his disciples, if ye had known me, ye would have known my Father also.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Okay, so there's still people that wonder, would God do this? Would God do that? Mm-hmm. Tornadoes swooped through Joplin. Some people said, God didn't do that. Mm-hmm. So what happened? Was the creation hijacked by someone, by an enemy?
No.
These people don't think about what they're saying.
That's right.
This is God's world. If God didn't manage it, the whole town would have been wiped out.
That's right.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
It was a managed. That was a managed catastrophe.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Some of you were delivered from it. Mm-hmm. People that weren't, that doesn't mean they were lost. But what God wanted done was done.
Amen.
Amen.
You had known me. You had known my Father also. And again, he said, he that's seen me has seen the Father. So you don't have to like sit down at home and meditate and think and ponder what's God like. You want to know what God's like? You look at Jesus.
Amen.
You look at Christ. You look at his ministry. Look,
yes.
Look at what he said. Look at what he did. Look the kind of people he preferred.
Yeah.
Okay, any aspect of God that is in fact knowable, was lived out in the person of Christ. That's why the Gospels are so important. And he said, See, Jesus of Nazareth was a perfect depiction of God. But these people he's talking to, they didn't see this. Mm-hmm. So he said to them, ye receive me not. Oh, that's a fearful thing to hear from Jesus.
Yes.
The NIV says, you do not accept me. Mm-hmm. He was sent to be accepted.
Yeah.
American Standard says, ye receive me not. Your hearts are not open to me, basically Bible English says. You refuse to accept me, New Jerusalem Bible. New Living Translation, you've rejected me. Living Bible, you refuse to welcome me. You either dismiss me or avoid me, Message Bible says. And you do not receive me, your hearts are not open to me. You give me no welcome, the Amplified Bible says. Which means, see, this is a very pregnant sentence.
Yeah, yeah.
That's how these people try to open it up. It means there's a lot. There's a lot here. It just isn't like you turned your head. It's not that simple. In other words, when Jesus was here, he gave enough evidence that it was unforgivable to ignore him.
Amen.
He made clear who he was. Mm-hmm. And if he didn't see it, he said it. He told it.
Yeah.
Ye receive me not. Why did they reject Jesus? Because they'd rejected God. See? They hadn't sought God like God ordained them to do, as Acts 17, 26 and 27 says. They didn't love and honor God, so they rejected the one God sent. Now, if another come in his own name, with his authority, it'd be himself. He has his own credentials, so to speak, and he's promoting his own agenda. If someone like that comes, you receive him. Maybe he's like an inventor. Maybe he has managed to accumulate a lot of followers. Maybe he has some very impressive educational credentials. See? He's coming in his own name, though. See, he's saying, now, this is what I can do. Jesus said, that's not how I came. I didn't come telling you what I could do. I come telling you what God can do.
Yeah.
See, there's a difference. You got to search.
Amen.
You got to search what Jesus said, and you'll see that this is actually what he did. He didn't come to promote himself.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't say, look, I lived for 30 years, and nobody, I never did one time sin. No one pointed out any default in me for the first 30 years of my life. See, he didn't come in his own name.
That's right.
On authority. By way of contrast, these men he's talking to were very interested in others who are motivated by pride.
Yeah.
Now, if you've walked in higher circles of the church world where there's the dignitaries and this sort of thing, there's an enormous amount of bragging that goes on. There he is. And I saw this as a young man. I could sense this is not right. You get together and you have bragging rights, you know. But some people will accept, they'll accept you just because of your credentials. In fact, if preachers are looking to be employed by a church, they will not be asked what God thinks of them. They will not be asked about how devoted they are to God. They will not be. They'll be asked about their credentials. They'll have to recommend themselves. If they have a hard time recommending themselves, they'll be rejected. This is just the way it operates, brother. It's uncomely, but this is the truth.
Yeah, Jesus was kind of clear about that. He said, I can do nothing
of myself.
So see that, how would that go for you in an interview? Well, I just can't do anything unless Jesus moves me.
That's right.
Works in me.
See, he's making a point here because these people had followed. There were certain people that rose to the surface of the Jewish economy. But it was people that they came in their own name. Like I said, Gamaliel was one of the, he was a top-ranking person. But if you were to say, why was he so ranked so highly? I mean, the Holy Spirit doesn't say God taught him or God led him or... course, he didn't believe in Jesus himself.
Yeah.
That's how great Gamaliel was. And Josephus, who's quoted all the time, he didn't believe in him either. They came with it. These men come in their own name.
Yes, that's right.
And Jesus said, someone comes in their own name, you'll receive them. Mm-hmm. But here the Creator sent me. I have a universal message. It's not a selective message. It's a universal message. And it directly relates to obtaining divine approval. Mm-hmm. And you turn away from me. So that moved him to pose a question. How can you believe? Now that's an unanswerable question. How can you believe? Another verse, the basic Bible English says, how is it possible for you to have faith? Here's the Jewish Bible, how can you trust? How are you able to believe, another version says. New Living Translation says, no wonder you can't believe. Amplified Bible says, how is it possible for you to believe? How can you learn to believe? All right, Jesus introduces a thought here that will be difficult for some to receive, or trust none well, here can receive it. He reveals that there are some approaches to the living God that make it impossible for the person to believe. There are some approaches to religion that make it impossible for the people who embrace that approach to believe on Christ. That's what you got right here. He wasn't talking about Pilate or Herod or some members of the Roman Senate. He's talking to the religious people, the elite, religious elites. How can you believe? Christ is going to establish that while they would not believe, it's because they could not believe.
Yeah, amen. Yeah.
That's what he's going to establish. Yeah. Now this, for a person that's not been exposed to this, this is kind of tough to accept, but this is, if you can't accept it, then you've got to answer this question. How can you believe? How can you, put it this way, how can you believe that receive honor one from another?
Yeah.
How can you? There really is, as I said, no answer to the question. It was a point of holy reasoning. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That when you embrace the teaching of someone who doesn't know God, it renders you incapable of believing.
Yeah.
Amen.
Even if you confront the Son of God himself. They've confronted the Son of God himself. Uh-huh. But they had embraced a view that made believing impossible.
That's right. Yeah. We might say they judged themselves
unworthy.
Yeah.
Now maybe there's more of this than we think. Now I'm quick to say we don't want to be hasty. Our job isn't to determine who is in this category, but there are people in this category.
That's right.
And maybe you've worked for people with people, maybe that's why they didn't believe. Maybe they couldn't. Mm-hmm. That's just something to think about.
Oh, yeah.
Please don't anyone try to draw decisions on this. I don't know how you'd really.
We want to make sure we're not one.
Dude, that's the main thing. Main thing is don't you be one.
Yeah,
can't believe.
Amen.
Yeah.
That's why some people, when they hear the truth, they shake their head. See, they've got some kind of a thinking. There's a direction in their thought that makes it impossible for them to believe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, the Holy Spirit, if a person will just listen, the Holy Spirit can address that.
Amen.
Convince the world of sin, of righteousness,
right.
of judgment. See, he can address that situation where you will not be able to yourself.
Yes.
You can reason with them, but. So Jesus knew these people. How could you? I don't expect honor from you. I don't expect it because you can't believe that I came out from God. That's what you're having trouble with. You're having trouble with where I come from and who sent me. And how can, because you don't honor me. That's why. You don't honor me.
Yeah.
That's why.
Yeah, Brother Gibbon.
be possible then that it says that he that believeth, all things are possible to him that believeth. But that is a requirement.
Oh,
you
yes.
do have to be able to believe.
That's right.
So now if Satan, who is watching all this,
yeah.
sees that there are areas or bodies of thought that will actually
yeah.
distract
oh,
you
yeah.
so much
oh,
that
yeah.
you won't. Well, of course he's going to major on those
yeah.
things.
Yeah, this it's important to see that. Go ahead, Brother Tony.
Well, I was going
to
say, we already know in this case that their religion was more important to them than God.
Yeah.
That's right.
It,
uh-huh.
was, it was something they had developed and all, and this was very, very important to them. Mm. It even placed it above God. So this, we know in their case,
mm-hmm.
this is what was keeping them from believing.
Yes,
yeah.
amen.
That's right.
See, the gospel is the power of God unto salvation.
Yes.
When the gospel is preached and someone is drawn to it and believes it, it overthrows this propensity to
Amen.
Unbelief.
That's right.
But when a person holds on mm. to the traditions of men and won't let it go, God won't let them believe.
Yeah.
They can't. In that state, they can't believe.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. In fact, what you said a while ago, and it was made something very clear to me, mm. which was actually astounding. And Jesus didn't come in His own name; He came in the Father's name.
Yes.
Those who are truly worshiping God
yeah.
were picked up on Jesus
That's
right,
right
off the bat.
That's
yeah.
right.
I never saw that so clearly.
That's
uh-huh.
right.
Just a man. He didn't need to come in His own name.
That's right.
He
yeah.
came in the
Amen.
Father's name, and those who belong to God went right to
That's
Him.
That's right. This is He.
Yeah, it's a...
We found Him. We found. See, they were looking. That's exactly right. And John the Baptist, he preached. He prepared people.
Mm-hmm.
He uprooted them from this. Stereotyped approach.
Amen.
Yes, but
it seems that what they were dealing with was a collection of stumbling blocks that they had
uh-huh.
accrued for a long time and basically had built the wall. It was the wall that they had built
yeah.
was the reason they could not.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah.
If the stumbling stones were gone, then they could.
Mm.
But it was these things they held on to, which
yeah.
makes me mindful of what when Jesus looked at from the other side and said, unless you become like a little child,
mm-hmm. Amen.
Uh-huh.
that doesn't have any of those collections
that's
yeah.
right.
of
yeah.
things
that's right.
yet. You tell them something, they believe it.
That's mm-hmm. right.
And so none of us can believe either unless we become like that little child.
That's right.
And throw away all the things we've
Amen.
Been
Amen. Amen.
Now,
most of us here, if not all of us, know what is involved in overcoming erroneous views. It's not something that's done easily. And I think that's by design.
Yeah, yeah.
You got to have a fight of faith. You have to battle against imaginations and thoughts that exalt
Amen.
Themselves against the knowledge of God. So you got to fight against those. But if a person does, he won't lose.
Amen.
If you fight against these, you won't lose. See?
Yeah.
Resists the devil always flees.
Yeah, that's right.
It always happens.
Amen.
In the meantime, there is an approach to Christianity that does not leave the person with confidence
mm.
and assurance. They just are not sure. They wonder whether they're in or out. And
mm-hmm.
that works against you
oh, yeah.
in overcoming the past. So if we can assist anybody, if you see traits of faith in a person,
mm-hmm.
tell them about this.
Amen.
These are good things,
yeah.
and commend them
mm-hmm.
for their faith and commend them. It may seem small to you, but if they're persuaded, anything, commend them for it because it's imperative that they have assurance or they will not be able to overcome
Amen.
Some of these other matters. How can you believe what receive honor one from another? And seek not the honor coming only from God. Well, should a person seek honor from God? Yeah, yes.
Yeah.
Here's a marvelous expression of this in Romans 2, 6 and 7. I don't see where I have it here. Oh, yeah, here it is. To them who by patient continuance in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality. Right? They're
yeah.
seeking for They're seeking for glory and honor and immortality. What do they get? Eternal life.
Yes, amen.
That's anyone who's doing this now.
Yeah.
That's anyone who's doing this.
Brother Kim, but it's true to say that we seek the glory of God only through believing in Christ. We can't do it any other way.
Oh, no, you can't do it any other way, yes. Yeah. But then this way is our glory. It's our glory. God gets glory out of us seeking to be glorified, in other words. So God, it's been made known to us that God's purpose is that in the end we're glorified. Whom he foreknew, he predestinated to be conformed to the image of the Son, and be predestinated, he called, to be called, he justified, he glorified. Now, the person who's seeking glory is seeking that. That's the glory he's seeking. And he's seeking the honor, the well done, good and faithful servant. He's seeking, it's called a crown of righteousness.
That's right.
Thou hast been faithful over a few things. He's seeking that. And he endeavors with all his might to appropriate that. God's going to give eternal life.
Yes.
To those people. Now, he said, said to his audience, you're not seeking the honor that comes from God only. Oh. You can't get this honor anywhere else.
Amen.
Men can't give it to you. Institution can't give it to you. Methodology can't give it to you. It's got to come from God.
Yeah,
and so the purpose of good preaching and teaching is to induce people to seek a city that has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. Who wants to see a better country.
Yeah.
See, that's how things all through the ages have sensed. It can't be what's here. Even at its best state, when the fields are fertile and yielding and everything, this has got to be more than this.
Yeah.
And when you seek it, you will honor Jesus, because Jesus, he's the ultimate provider.
Amen.
It is continuance in well-doing, who by patient means enduring, patient continuance and well-doing. This is well-doing is defined by God. Now, how well are you doing? It's good to ask yourself, how well am I doing? God's going to assess what I'm doing.
Yeah.
So I'm going to get the jump on this now. And how well am I doing? Well, I can tell you there's some areas I got to apply some work to. Just like the ladies cleans the house, you know, there's some sections they got to apply a little more energy. Life's that way. There's some areas of your life you'll have to apply a little more effort. And you'll do it if you're seeking for glory and honor and immortality.
Amen.
You'll do that. And it will not be in vain. Your labor's not in vain in the Lord.
Yes. Amen.
Now, Paul described his personal quest for glory. He said, I want to be found in him, not having mine own righteousness, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable to his death, if by any means I might attain to the resurrection of the dead. So he's telling you, that's why I did what I did. That's why I overthrew my religious career. That's why I held up under those beatings I had and didn't give up, kept going. That's why I shook that snake off on the island. See?
Yeah.
That's why I held up during that 14-day storm at sea. That's why. That's why I fought with beasts after the manner of men in Ephesus. This is why I did that. Because of what I saw ahead. I want to be... Peter's put it this way. He said, Beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him. That's when he comes again. Found of him in peace, without spot, and blameless. That's your aim.
Yeah.
When Jesus comes, you need to be at peace, without spot, and blameless.
Mm-hmm.
You say, well, how can I be without spot and blameless? Confess your sins.
Yes.
Every day, confess it.
Yes.
Always start the day with a clean slate.
Yes.
Do it. Yes.
Satan's done a very effective job of convincing God's people that to seek glory and honor is presumptuous and selfish.
In
worldly circles, it's okay, though. Like you said, the promoting of credentials.
Yeah. Yeah,
always prefaced with not to brag.
Yeah.
And then it's, you know, followed by some bragging. But I remember when this dawned on me a few years ago, and then I started seeing it in the scriptures, that it is, whatever you want to call it, it's encouraged by God and his people. He wants us to press toward the goal.
Yes.
He wants us to win. There is a prize at the end.
Yeah.
We're to press for it. But I remember that I kind of got some people upset when I presented what I perceived as some pretty good news.
Yes, I know what
you're saying. The devil has a way to twist that.
Oh,
that's unfortunate.
Yeah.
When God's people get, I think my point is, he realizes how powerful this truth is. Once God's people see it, then they start throwing stuff off.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And so it's high stakes for him, I guess.
Yeah.
Oh, I praise God. That's
yes.
That knowledge is available.
Yes. Amen.
It simplifies things and makes everything doable.
Yes.
And the Lord lays out a pretty ambitious future for the saints of God.
Amen.
But this makes it all doable. You only have to live a day at a time.
Yeah.
I guess a minute at a time if you really want to get down to it.
Yeah.
So you're not just settling the whole thing at one time. I thank God that there's time broken up.
Yeah.
Gives you a chance to get things straightened up before you begin the next segment.
Yeah.
Huh? Learn a little bit, gain a little bit of ground, see? It's good.
Amen.
So I'm thankful for the gathering of the saints when we get advantage from other people have experienced,
we get
advantage from it.
Amen.
And John put it this way, he talked about this too. He said about not being ashamed before him at his coming. Mm. Oh no, Jesus, I didn't think you'd come today. Mm. You don't want to be in that kind of a state. Jesus is not seeking a reason to condemn anybody.
Yeah. Amen.
If that's what God wanted, there's plenty of reason for that.
Yeah.
He's looking for a reason to save you. Mm-hmm. That's why he has devoted so many resources, see?
Yeah.
You've got resources in heaven, God, Christ, Spirit, holy angels. Got resources on earth, and it's all to ensure that you make it to the end.
Amen.
See? And that you seek, and if you seek it, they that seek find. See?
Amen.
That's the promise.
Yes.
Amen.
If you knock, it will be opened. See? It, matter of fact, one gospel where it says, everyone that seeks finds.
Amen.
That's the kind of economy we're in, brother.
Yes.
That's the kind of economy salvation is. Doesn't make it learned, unlearned, young, old, married, single, male, female, Jew, Greek. You apply yourself and seek it, you'll get it.
Yeah.
Our job now is to help everybody to understand some of the things that can be sought. If it can be sought, it can be obtained.
Yes.
See,
yes.
So you're probably like me. You learn almost every day some new thing that you can appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
Some attitude, some mindset, some gift, some benefit, some perspective. There's hardly any end to it.
Amen.
Any of you have something you'd like to add? Yes, Brother Jonathan?
Yeah, people are going to see Jesus for who he really is. They have to believe him.
Mm-hmm.
There's this matter of credibility in our day, who people count to be a reliable witness. And you mentioned Josephus. I don't read him. Didn't you say he didn't believe he was the Christ,
right?
No, he
didn't believe,
That's why he sold his doors.
Yeah.
I'm fully to believe if he did believe Jesus was the Christ, no one would, everything he said would be under the category of so what?
Yeah.
No one would care. He would not even be considered a credible historian. But the big reason, the unbelievers will show one of their people, acknowledge him, and then they'll come around. But if that's your foundation, what the unbeliever says, you're just going to have a Josephus view of Jesus.
That's right. Uh-huh,
that's right.
You need to have what the apostles said about Jesus.
That's
you need
exactly
to have what Jesus
right.
said about Jesus.
Amen.
So, I mean, their credibility, what they need to be presented, they're the credible ones.
Amen.
Yeah, the unbelievers never carry any weight over Jesus Christ. You can't
mm-hmm.
take that approach. Because whatever you use as your foundation, you're going to take that person's view of
yeah.
Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
See, you had Pilate and Herod were eyewitnesses of Christ, right?
Yeah.
But we don't go to them for a witness. Josephus said some things about Jesus, like how tall he was, what color his hair was, that he went about doing very impressive things. But it was all very, very general and ambiguous. It wasn't anything you hang your soul on. God will not let anyone that's unapproved of him give a telling and dependable testimony about Christ. There'll be something about it that's not adequate.
To make it a point to use unschooled, ordinary man.
Yeah. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's right.
They will be made, taken notice of, and only God can be credited. Otherwise, how could they have known any of those things?
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Now, you know, all of you here tonight know by experience the effects that seeing the truth has on you.
That's right.
No matter if you're a beginner or you've been in the faith for a long time, seeing the truth has such an impact on the soul.
Mm-hmm.
See, God's got to be in that. There's nothing that could have this kind of a effect upon the human spirit unless God was in it and Christ was in it and the Holy Spirit was in it, see? And so that accounts for the impact it has. And sometimes it's when you see it, you wonder, why didn't I see this before, you know?
Yeah. Amen.
But it's not hard to see. See, when it's opened up to you, you just see, the first time it's opened up, you got it. Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
It's not like that with the wisdom of the world.
Amen.
Yeah, yes, Brother Robert.
Thing that, God's incentive program.
Yeah.
You know, he's,
Amen.
You as you walk in the Spirit, you'll have an inclination that you want more of God. You want more
yeah.
of him. I mean, he's satisfying,
yeah.
but he's not, it doesn't satiate your satisfaction. It's like, okay, I got enough now. It's always drawing you.
That's right.
You want more and
yeah.
more. And why is that? Because he's put that desire in you
yeah.
to move you along.
Yeah.
You know, and so here we don't have a continuing city, but we seek one,
yeah.
so that this is part and parcel of walking with Christ. He'll draw you. You thought you knew more yesterday. Well, wait, today you're going to get more.
Yeah.
You're going to get more, and
yeah.
so it should. It actually this should be expected in me, in all of us, that as you see Christ more clearly, you want to see him more clearly.
Yeah.
That's just a part of the deal. That Isaiah 61:3, I think he's already been mentioned. He'll give you beauty for ashes, but you do got to give up the ashes.
That's right.
You got to give up that thing that was lesser to get the thing
yeah.
that's better.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, when you begin, there is a displacement where the,
yeah.
the old is pushed out. But you got to eventually, here's what happens.
Mm-hmm.
When you get something, you're enlarged.
Amen, that's right.
So, because this is added.
Yes.
This is added to you.
Yes.
It isn't that you have the ABCs down here, and then you finally once you learn how to use the ABCs, you don't have to quote them anymore.
That's
see,
right.
You can imagine what we'd say if you went to a college graduation and for a guy's speech, he recited the ABCs.
Yeah.
You'd say, well, that's what happened. When you receive from God,
uh-huh.
you are enlarged
yes.
to add that. That's added to what you have. It doesn't displace.
Uh-huh.
See?
Amen.
Anyone else? Yes, Sister Melissa.
I was thinking about this honor that comes from God,
yeah.
that it's opposite of the honor that comes from
yeah.
men.
Yeah.
You know, like you said, that men, you had a problem with that. It's because their idea of honor was different than what really the honor from God
yeah.
is. It's much more than what people can imagine here, but part of that honor we get now is knowing God. I mean, it's an honor to know God.
Oh, amen.
He reveals things to you and you learn more about him. That's like he's giving you honor.
Yes.
Amen.
asking.
Yes.
This honor that we seek made me think of Hebrews 11, verse 16. It says, they desire a better country yeah. that is in heavenly.
Amen.
Wherefore God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city.
Amen.
This world will see us laying hold on eternal life and wonder what we're doing. But that's because that they can't offer what we're chasing
that's
after.
Right. That's right.
Well, chasing after is kind of a clumsy way to say it. But the world can't offer what we're going to get.
Yeah.
That's why they look at us like we're strange. Is because what are you trying to achieve? We can't offer that. Why should you want it?
Yeah.
But the thing is, we have the higher view.
Amen.
The better country that is in heavenly requires the greatest open-mindedness that you can ever think of. People say, you should be more open-minded.
Mm-hmm.
How much more open-minded can we be? We're seeking a heavenly country.
Hmm. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, when people used to say to me, be more open-minded, I told them, well, your brains will fall out if you're...
Given there's some attributes of God that, when mixed with unrighteousness here on the earth, become very bad. Jealousy is one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's righteous for God to be jealous.
Yeah. There
it's
you
not
are.
Righteous for us to be,
very
because
good.
Unrighteousness corrupts
mm-hmm.
that.
Yeah.
And the same thing is true of glory and honor.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
It's perfectly natural for a righteous God to seek to be honored, seek to be glorified by us, but when we do it, because we're corrupted, how presumptuous for us to seek glory
yeah.
for ourselves.
Yeah.
But the neat thing is that when we do reach that finish line,
yeah.
there will be glory
there
for us.
Be.
And
Amen.
It will be the kind of glory that's a righteous one.
Amen.
It's okay.
Uh-huh. Be a shared glory.
That's
right.
Glory.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. Amen.
Mm-hmm.
And in that glory, we'll be bringing glory to the Lord.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, God will be glorified by dispensing glory. And he'll lose, none of his glory is going to be diminished.
That's right.
All right, very good.